The Rebel Capitalist Show, episode 17. Okay, it gives me a great deal of pleasure to welcome someone to the Rebel Capitalist Show that I really enjoy listening to. I hear him all the time on my good buddy Chris Irons' podcast, Quote the Raven. His name is Mark Spiegel. Welcome to the Rebel Capitalist Show.
Yeah, I don't know how much of a rebel I am. I mean, Chris has all those tattoos. I got nothing, you know. So, but all right, fine. I'm happy to be here. Thank you.
Yeah, so I usually interview a lot of the macro folks, so Luke Groman, Brent Johnson. I just interviewed Rick Rule. But I don't get the opportunity to often interview actual fund managers or hedge fund managers and really get a chance to analyze their more bottoms-up approach. And I think that's so important in today's environment if you're trying to not just make money, but keep the purchasing power that you already have. But for those of my viewers or listeners who don't understand or don't know your backstory, can you kind of fill in the gaps for us?
Sure. Well, I opened Stanfill in 2011, so over 8 years ago now. Before that, I spent a number of years on Wall Street as an investment banker on the sell side. And before that, I had a completely different career when I got out of college, which was in commercial real estate, mostly brokerage in the New York City borough. So I came to Wall Street actually when I was 41 years old. So, which is very unusual, but I worked with a lot of business guys for 17 years in commercial real estate and learned how businesses work and how to talk to those guys. And that's how I sort of talked my way into a banking job on Wall Street without any of that on my resume. They figured, oh, well, you know, if he can talk to a guy running a company about his real estate, he can talk to him about raising his money. And that's all banking is, essentially, or it's M&A. So anyway, so that's my background in a nutshell.
Okay, fantastic. And now you're running this fund, which is really kind of a deep value fund. And correct me if I'm not describing it accurately, but it's a deep value fund. And then on the flip side of that, if you see something where the fundamentals are completely out of whack, then you'll take the short side of that. So you're kind of
nice grin in this environment. I'll take the short side of something where the fundamentals are out of whack.
Yeah. And you're very well known for shorting Tesla. And we might get into that a little bit later. But I know your time is very valuable. And I think that a lot of your content out there, especially with Chris, is talking about your thesis for that fundamental short. But I don't think there's a lot of your content out there where people actually get to understand your approach to investing. And I think just for the layman, the average Joe out there, for them to understand how your process works from A to Z, I think it just would really, really help them out. So when you're trying to find an investment, I know you take a more of a what they call a bottoms up approach, where you start with kind of the balance sheet and maybe the P&L and then go from there. But even with the balance sheet, let's say, what's the first thing that you look at and how do you say, okay, this is great, I need to pay more attention to this, or maybe this is a good short opportunity? How does that even start?
Great question. As a deep value guy, my favorite metric to look at is enterprise value to revenue, which of course takes into account the balance sheet, the net cash. And the reason I do that is simple. If I can buy revenue cheaply enough, then I have really good, usually, not always, downside risk protection, because there's always some strategic buyer that will come along and buy that revenue, you know, as an add-on to its own business if it's cheap enough. So that's basically what I do. And you know, on the long side, I'm almost entirely in these sort of deep value, micro cap, nano cap companies. It's a very inefficient market. It's a market where a guy running, you know, billions of dollars might look at these companies and say, yeah, that's an interesting little company, but I can't touch that because I'm running in billions of dollars. Well, that's not my problem. I'm running millions of dollars and not that many millions. So I can play in this space. Even for me, sometimes it's hard to accumulate these companies, but that's what I look at. I like to buy cheap revenue. So, and I like these companies to either be, sometimes they're making some money, which is great, but I like them to be either at least breaking even or not losing very much money and having plenty of net cash on the balance sheet to cover those losses until they can get turned around. And that's what I look at. If you ask me one thing.
Yeah, that's really interesting because, correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems like you've taken a real estate approach to looking at stocks from the standpoint where you're looking at, you're buying cash flow stream. It's almost like looking at a cap rate on a commercial.
Well, I'm not really buying cash flow. Some of these companies aren't generating cash flow. But what I'm saying is, you know, if I can buy, you know, my typical sort of bogey, what I look for ideally is to buy a company at 1x annual gross profit or less, whether or not it's making money. So plain English, you know, if a company is doing $100 million in revenue with a 50% gross margin, so that's $50 million in annual gross profit, I'll look to buy that company for $50 million or less. Okay. Because what typically happens is a strategic buyer can come along and say, oh, that little thing shouldn't be a standalone public company. You know, I can eliminate $4 or $5 million from, you know, auditing fees and exchange fees and the C-suite and their own headquarters. And all of a sudden, the company which I bought, which was sort of breaking even, there's a strategic buyer that in this market might be selling for 2x revenue. Okay. I just bought this company for 0.5x revenue. That strategic could easily come in and pay 1x revenue for that company. I've doubled my money and he's bought it for, you know, a 50% discount to what the market is valuing his company at on a revenue basis. So that's my ideal situation. Now, that said, you know, I don't want to buy a cigar Bart. I don't want to buy, you know, the yellow pages, you know, when the internet is coming. So, I try to buy companies that at least have some chance of turning around or at least just kind of sitting there until somebody buys them. And in this bubble, which it is, and we can talk macro if you want, it's not easy to find those. I mean, I have maybe 4 long positions now that sort of fit that criteria. You know, ideally, I'd like to have 10 or 15 or 20 of them, but they're hard to find. So I'm holding cash, basically.
Right. And so why is it that you would like to have that more of those investment opportunities instead of consolidating your portfolio into the ones that are your favorites? Is that so you've got the diversification, so you spread out your risk? Or from a professional manager's standpoint, how do you look at that?
Well, it's a great question. Number one, I'd like to put more money to work on the long side. I mean, right now we're, you know, call it roughly 50% invested on the long side, maybe 40%, you know. And number two, yeah, I mean, some of these companies I have maybe a 10 or 15% position in. Ideally, maybe I'd want it to be a 5 or 6 or 7% position, but they're hard to find. And I feel that my risk is controlled on the downside, so I'll go a little bit bigger in them. But if I could generate the same returns from 20 companies as from 4, that's always better. You know, you sleep better, you know, the night before the conference call, right? So,
yeah,
you know. Yes.
Yeah. You know, one thing I'd love to get your professional opinion on, because I get this question and I've tried to figure this out myself. If you're keeping a substantial amount of powder dry, you're just the average guy out there. Let's say you've got, you know, $100,000 in cash that you think maybe the market's going to correct or something. So you just want to keep that powder dry. Like I said, what is the professional way to do that? Do you keep that just in the bank or do you guys keep it in T-bills and just roll it over every 3 months to at least get some sort of return on there? And how do the pros do that?
Well, for us, it's in our prime brokerage account, and our prime is Interactive Brokers. And, you know, they pay us some interest on the cash balance. In fact, the other thing that IB does, which most retail brokers won't do, is they actually pay us interest on the cash balance on our short positions, which is a little bit unusual. I mean, TD Ameritrade and Fidelity aren't going to do that. So, yeah, I mean, I want that cash available, so I'm not going to have it tied up in a 3-month T-bill or anything like that.
Well, from a professional standpoint, what would you suggest just the normal guy do that had the 100 grand that they wanted to, you know, save for a rainy day to take advantage of a downturn in the market or the real estate market?
I would say that with what you can collect on a T-bill these days, you're better off having it in cash and, you know, and so it's available immediately if you need to use it. You know, have it in cash in your brokerage account. or whatever. You know, if we get a 15% market correction. By the way, you know, I've been guilty of this myself many times, but more as a hedge than anything else. Very hard to call a market. I mean, we've got right now, I mean, so I had run longs and shorts, you know, for years in this fund. And basically, mostly net long, except you know, this Tesla thing and a few other things. But in, I guess it was in October, or maybe November. I think October was when the Fed, if I remember right, ended quantitative tightening. And then I believe it was December when Powell said, we're going to actually start printing money again, essentially buying $60 billion a month of short-term treasuries. And when I heard that, I covered all of my equity shorts except Tesla. And we can get into that, but the reason is obvious. These guys are just going to pump up stock prices until they destroy the dollar. And I don't know when that's going to happen. I mean, you know, Peter Schiff, who I love watching, is on TV all the time saying, you got to own gold now. They're going to blow it all up. Well, you know, the Bank of Japan hasn't blown up Japan yet, you know, in 30 years. So I don't deign, if deign isn't the right word, I don't pretend to understand the timing of this thing. But, you know, I don't want to be, generally speaking, I don't want to be short equities in this market. As a friend of mine once said, it's like sitting down at a poker table and the guy across from you has a chip making machine on his lap, right? And that's right. The Fed. And every time you short his stock, he pushes a button and pops out a chip and calls you, right? It's just, it's a losing proposition while the Fed is printing money. If they stopped QE and there was price discovery in stocks, because there's no question this is a valuation bubble, it would be a different story. But the reason I just gave you that whole preface was we happen to be right now short the NASDAQ QQQ entirely as a hedge for this coronavirus thing, which, you know, clearly is much worse in China than China is saying. Does the market know that? Maybe, maybe not. I don't know. Is it going to get heat? Is it going to, you know, come to the US and Western Europe and be a big problem? I don't know. I mean, I don't see why it wouldn't, but maybe it won't. Maybe they've caught it and isolated it to China. So as a hedge, I'm short the Qs. Once I start feeling that, you know, that this is under control, this coronavirus, and okay, so, you know, maybe we missed 6 weeks of earnings, right? Or even a quarter of earnings. Well, you know, with the multiples people are paying for stocks now, they're obviously discounting the next 20 years of earnings in order to pay a gap PE of 26 or whatever it is for the S&P 500. I mean, it's crazy. And that one missed quarter isn't going to mean anything. And I assume that's what the market is thinking. So if it turns out that that's correct, I won't be short stocks while the Fed is printing money, other than isolated, you know, situations, for instance, like Tesla, or, you know, if there's a short term catalyst for something.
So one of the things that you're discussing right now, as far as looking at the market and comparing this and kind of trying to figure out how the coronavirus plays into this, what kind of boggles my mind is, now that we've kind of gone through this, you know, when it first came out, it wasn't a big deal. It's just the flu. And now even the World Health Organization is kind of saying, okay, well, sorry, guys, maybe this is a little bit bigger deal than we thought. But then the market goes to all-time highs and continues to go up. Is that because, from a macro standpoint, you think the market has gone back to good news is bad news, meaning that bad news is good news from the standpoint we get more bad news, well, that just means the Fed is going to print more money, and therefore I want to be long because there's not only a put, but the Fed is going to do everything they can to juice the market because of the bad news we have?
I don't think it's that so much as the Fed is doing everything it can to print money and juice the market, and this coronavirus won't be a big deal, and it'll be gone in a month, and okay, you know, we'll make it up with double the GDP growth in Q2. You know, we'll make up for it. You know, I mean, I think that's what the market's thinking. I mean, the market has no doubt that this Fed is just going to keep printing money and blowing this bubble. I mean, even today, Powell testifying in Congress, you know, multiple times talked about his symmetrical inflation target. And to him, that means, oh, well, you know, we had, and obviously, and you must talk about this all the time, but, you know, they have their bullshit metric, which is, you know, PCE core, right? CPI core, which is sort of reasonable. I mean, I don't want to get into a whole discussion of how much that understates things, but CPI core has been 2.3% for a long time now. PCE core, I believe, is like 1.6. It's like a totally nonsensical metric the Fed uses. And according to them, well, if we've had, you know, 10 years of 1.5, then we have to have 10 years of 2.5 in order to be quote unquote symmetrical at 2%. And you must have guests all the time who talk about this random 2% as if it's some sacred thing from God on the Ten Commandment tablets or whatever. But it is what it is. So if that's what the Fed is aiming for, I mean, the only thing that's really going to kill this market will be enough consumer. I mean, let me back up. The only thing that's going to kill this market and keep it killed, you know, because look, we could have a coronavirus scare tomorrow in this market in the U.S. and this market could tank 20% over the next 6 weeks for sure. But I wouldn't want to stay short beyond that because, yeah, then the Fed will take the printing from $60 billion a month to $100 billion a month or whatever. But what will there are two things I think that would kill this market. One is enough consumer price inflation to spook the Fed. And that would be defined as probably something like 3% on their PCE core, which is basically, you know, a point and a half higher than we've got now or something close to that. You know, that would spook the Fed. And what would happen is they would stop printing money, even if they didn't immediately raise rates, and we'd get big PE multiple compression on stocks and the market would crash. The second thing that would spook this market would be if Bernie Sanders were elected. If the market started thinking that Sanders is our next president, it'll tank stocks for obvious reasons. I mean, he'd be very unfriendly to corporate profits. But that said, Sanders, you'd have a window probably, you know, between when everyone was sure Sanders would win and then after his first few months in office, until his first few months in office, because he would appoint the most dovish Fed chairman in the history of the Fed who would print mega amounts of money because right. he would run our deficits. I mean, Trump has run these terrible deficits of a trillion or a trillion two. He'd be running, you know, $2 and $3 and $4 trillion deficits and hiring some Fed idiot like this jerk Kashkari, you know, to just print all the money he needs. And, you know, that would be hugely inflationary. It would destroy the dollar and it would, you know, inflate nominal stock prices through the roof. I mean, you know, when Venezuela became socialist, the stock market soared. So I would not want to be short nominal stock prices, you know, during a Sanders administration, you know. So it's funny. I have a good friend who wrote about this on Seeking Alpha. His theory is that one of the reasons the Fed has got the pump going nonstop now is as much as they might, you know, despise Trump on a personal level, because, you know, he's just not part of the old boys network or old girls network. They are absolutely terrified of electing a socialist. And they're afraid that if they allow things to crash now, both stocks and the economy, it would usher Bernie Sanders into office. And that terrifies them for good reasons. I mean, it's one, maybe the one thing I agree with the Fed on. So they're going to keep the pump primed, you know, right until election night, when presumably Trump can safely be reelected because the economy is still doing pretty well. And then maybe they take their foot off the pump and say, okay, we're safe for 4 years. So from a broad market standpoint, the best time to short this market might be the day after election day, regardless of whether the winner, you know, is Trump or Sanders. If it's Sanders, it's for obvious reasons. And if it's Trump, it's because the Fed may finally take its foot off the pedal for a little while. So, but that's a ways to go. I mean, this is February and I'm talking about November here. So,
yeah. Have you looked into the TGA at all, which is the Treasury General account that they have with the Fed?
No. In what respect?
Well, I actually did a video on it the other day, and it was it was something that I saw on a Real Vision video that Raul Paul did. And toward the end of the video, he interviewed a guy by the name of Dr. Barton Wang. And this guy had a very interesting theory that if you look at a chart, you can just go to a Fred chart, of the Treasury General account that they have with the Fed. His theory, I guess, is that when the TGA goes up, that's pulling reserves out of the banking system. And therefore, that's that may have played into the repo market spiking, because it's sucking out all those reserves from the system, the dollar funding system. And that because the TGA now is at such huge levels, and when I mean huge levels, I mean it's at an all-time high right now at about $400 billion. Going back prior to 2008 with the GFC, it would range between $5 billion and like $6 billion. I mean, it is unbelievable when you see the chart of it. And his thing was from the middle of August, 2019 to the middle, right before the repo, they allowed that account to go up. The Treasury allowed it to go up by $190 billion just almost overnight. And therefore, you suck so many of those reserves out of the system, like I was saying earlier, that might have led to that repo spike. So he thinks that the opposite could be true, in the sense that if you've got someone that's listening to Trump or the administration, and now they're just kind of building this war chest of money, say they've got 400, 500, 600, he says before the election, they can go in and flood the market just by spending the money that increases the reserves with the banking system, and that juices the stock market. And he said that's basically like sidestepping the Federal Reserve and doing their own round of quantitative easing.
You know, coming into December, Zero Hedge, who I'm a huge fan of, and I wish they would get back on Twitter. I mean, exactly. I love their, I guess there's multiple Tylers, but they're very funny and they're financially savvy. But, you know, every day they were writing something about how the repo market was going to blow up in December, right? It was all going to explode. And some guy said this. And I just
Zoltan ignored, Pozar.
What's that?
Zoltan Pozar.
Right. And I just ignored it all. And the reason I ignored it is it's so friggin' obvious to me that, you know, the Fed is going to pull a Draghi and do whatever it takes. And they were going to print as much money as required for the repo market not to blow up, because, and this I'm sure Schiff talks about this stuff with you all the time, these guys can't see beyond the tips of their nose. Right. They don't want to be the one in office when this ridiculous bubble that they keep inflating and reinflating, you know, blows up. It's just going to be not on their watch. And look, I know Schiff's a big gold guy, and eventually, yeah, it's going to be gold. You know, listen, maybe for millennials it'll be Bitcoin. I mean, I think that's kind of nuts because it hasn't stood the test of time the way gold has, but that's a different discussion. I'm neither long nor short Bitcoin, nor would I ever be. But, you know, but this can take decades. You know, I mean, if you pull up a history book, I mean, it always ends the same way, right? I mean, Rome fell. One of the reasons was they printed money, essentially, right?
Right.
But, you know, I don't remember my Roman history, but it could go, you know, they could have started printing money at 40 BC and the empire might not have fallen until 300 AD. And I'm totally making those numbers up.
Right,
but
right.
This kind of crap can just take a lot longer than you think. And you know, Japan has a 30-year head start on us on this stuff. So in theory, you know, and they're at 245% federal government debt to GDP. So in theory, they should go first. But who knows? Maybe if Japan goes, all three currencies, you know, euro, dollar, and yen, will all go at the same time. Maybe it'll be a crisis of confidence. I just don't know. I just know that when you have a Fed that feels that price discovery is no longer relevant, mm-hmm. and that it's perfectly acceptable to distort both debt and equity markets by printing money and sustaining the bubble, well, that's the guy at the poker table with the chip making machine on his lap. And I don't want to be short equities. You know, I will consider, and I am actually via an ETF, this is one of my macro positions, being short certain bonds. I mean, we're short an ETF. The ticker is BNDX, Boy Nancy David X-Ray, and it's non-US sovereign debt. It's 10-year debt, basically, roughly 10-year debt. And it's like 10-year debt from Japan, Germany, France, Italy, you know, basically all these countries not in the U.S. and it's currency adjusted. So you don't have to worry that comes out of the equation. And, you know, so here's an ETF. It's got what's called an SEC real yield of less than 50 basis points. It's about 0.47% last time I looked. The average term on the debt is 9.7 years. It's absurd. I mean, 10-year money at less than 0.5% a year. So I'm short that. We get a rebate from our cash balance for the fund. So it's a positive carry trade, you know, other than the fluctuation in the price of the ETF itself, you know, it actually pays us a little bit on a net basis, even after I pay that dividend. So that's kind of my bet against the guy. My bet is that the guy with the poker machine wins and eventually destroys the bond market, which he will. But I don't know the timing of that. If that weren't a positive carry position, I wouldn't even be short that thing. You know, I wouldn't want to spend money to hold that and see what happens. You know, I mean, I guess that's the advantage of gold. Gold is neither positive nor negative. You can just sit on it, you know?
Yeah. And, you know, it's amazing to me that the Fed, and I mean, you're talking about how they're trying to now kind of rig the numbers so it seems like if they're overcooking the market from an inflation standpoint, that's actually what they're trying to do. And you got, I think Brainerd was the gal that came out and talked about pegging the curve just like they did in World War II. And that should be their goal, which, and most people don't realize, during that peg, it was about a 10-year peg, we had inflation that actually got higher than it got in the 1970s for a variety of reasons. But, you know, they're talking about that. So it's obvious.
By the way, that peg, as you seem to know, it didn't work. And the reason it didn't work was, out in the real world, they said, wait a second, this Fed, because this was after World War II when people were chasing all these goods, the real world said, this Fed is not serious about fighting inflation. The Fed tried to keep rates artificially low. Lending rates in the real world took off. They were much higher than those Fed rates. The Fed lost control of the bond market, is what they, you know, used to say. If people are old enough to remember that. And the Fed was forced to relent and unpeg interest rates. And, you know, that will happen here. I mean, once you start getting the real world inflation, it's not like the Fed is going to immediately say, oh, that's it. You know, the jig is up, guys. We got to stop printing money. No, the Fed will do exactly what you just said. Brainerd will say, oh, well, we can control those real rates. Well, guess what, guys? For a little while, you can. And then you can't, because, you know, you're going to crash the economy because real world lending will not take place where you want it to take place. And because they have no faith in you, they're charging more for money because they don't know how much worse inflation is going to get. You know, that will happen. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And what's interesting to me is that the Fed is obviously trying to bring on this inflation genie, but yet that inflation genie is the kryptonite that basically renders them impotent on a moving forward basis, because their only tools, you know, they're like that saying with the, when all you've got is a hammer and everything you see is a nail. Their only tools are just money printing and dropping interest rates, which
I guess. So they think they could control it. You know, obviously they think that that they realize how much debt is out there, and they figure, oh, well, you know, this way we can inflate the debt away, or at least, you know, not let people get behind on the debt. And that's what they're, you know, they created this bubble. They created conditions for this bubble. And now they're trying, and this is nothing new. I'm sure Schiff says this all the time. And now they're trying to manage the bubble by blowing the bubble bigger. I mean, the whole thing is absurd, but no one knows the timing of this thing. You know, look, I was one of those people who, you know, in 2010 or whatever, when they started QE, the first QE, I'm like, oh, that's it. We're going to get hyperinflation. Everyone said that. Schiff said that. Well, we were all wrong. Why were we wrong? Because this nonsense can go on much, much longer than you would think. There's a massive amount of international faith and confidence in the U.S. dollar. For multiple reasons, right? A lot of people still want to come to this country. It's the place of opportunity. We have these massive military, you know, which backs us, and that essentially backs the dollar to some extent. And a lot of other countries were a lot worse, right? So as long as there's faith and confidence in the dollar, the Fed can get away with this crap, right? You know, once that goes away, it's game over. I don't know the timing. I don't want to be short that, You know, I'm willing to bet that they eventually lose control if it's cheap enough. That's why I have that one, you know, ETF short. For a little while last year, I was short TLT, you know, which is the ETF of the 20 to 30 year term on treasuries. And I made a little money there. And fortunately, I covered it because, you know, I said to myself, if we do get a market correction, which we could at any time for various reasons, a stock market correction, you know, money will flee into those bonds. And so, you know, it's essentially, I just wasn't comfortable with that. But it's a really hard situation. Look, I mean, if you're a value investor, it's hard to find value, but you don't want to chase, you know, I mean, look, you're probably safe buying stocks here if you can if you can stomach a 20%, you know, drawdown for seemingly any reason, coronavirus, whatever it is. It is probably true that the Fed will have your back and they will print up nominal asset prices forever and ever and ever until they can't get away with it anymore. So if you're long stocks, I guess my warning is, you know, watch out for the kind of consumer price inflation that spooks the Fed or raises real world interest rates enough that you get multiple compression, PE multiple compression on stocks, because that's what will wreck stocks until they print so much damn money that in nominal terms, stocks will go up anyway. You know, we'll have Venezuela again. It's not a fair fight, but this is what we have, and this is what we have to adapt to.
So if interest rates go up because of that inflation that they're trying to create, how does that play out in the corporate bond market, which in my opinion is just as big of a bubble?
It'll be destroyed. Same thing with, you know, with sovereign debt. Maybe it'll be a little bit of a time lag on sovereign debt because, as you said, and as I guess Brainard said, they'll try to cap interest rates on sovereign debt, but they'll lose control and they won't be able to maintain that. Yeah, thing is, though, it's like, which corporates are you going to short? Because, you know, even though we have a higher inflation rate somewhat than Europe, our corporate interest rates are much higher than those in Europe or Japan. So I would look to short corporates in Europe and Japan and try to do it on a currency adjusted basis so you can pull that out of the equation. But sure, the bond market is a bigger bubble than the stock market, for sure. Like, without question. But, you know, again, it's a matter of timing and how long it's going to take. And, you know, there's no easy answer here because this nonsense can go on for decades.
Yeah.
Or it could end next Thursday. That's the thing, you know.
So. Yeah. You know, that takes me back to kind of a random question. And it deals more with the investment strategy side of the equation. And I think this is what so many just normal average Joes out there get wrong. And I'm really curious to get your thoughts on this. The way I look at investing, and I just try to keep it very simple because, you know, I understand the macro stuff to a certain extent, but to really get in the weeds from the way you need to understanding, you know, businesses from a bottoms up approach, I'm just not there yet. So the way I kind of keep it simple for my own portfolio is I compartmentalize it into three different categories. Number one would be insurance. Number two would be investments. And the way I define investments for myself would be they have to pay you to own them. So a very small, modest, single family starter home rental property. And then for another portion of the portfolio, which is very small for me, about 10%, that would be speculation. And the way I define that is you're just betting that the price of something is going to go up or down. And the reason I do that is just to your point, because the timing, you cannot figure out timing. And especially if you start with the question, and this is kind of what I see most people do, and I think it's such a huge mistake. The very first question they ask themselves is the price of what I'm considering, is it going to go up or is it going to go down? Where what I like to do is say, okay, that's a question that I want to answer down the line. But my first question is it cheap or is it expensive?
Yeah.
And I think if you start with that question, it really puts things into place, and you, especially for the average guy or girl, can have much better success over the long term. What are your thoughts on that?
Right. So the first thing, and this is advice that's been passed down, you know, generation to generation. The first thing you should always ask yourself is, how much can I lose here? Mm. Right. And, you know, you'd be surprised how many sort of casual stock market investors, you know, they'll buy some stock. I don't know. I mean, they'll buy Apple, which, by the way, is a great company. I have no position there. And this is not a knock on Apple. But they'll say, you know, where is Apple now? I don't even know where it is.
Who knows? I know they've gained like $300 billion in market cap in like the last 2 hours.
Okay. So Apple is, holy shit. Apple is $319 right now. Okay. So, you know, if Apple went down to $295 next month, I can't tell you how many friends I have who they're like, hey, I just bought Apple. I'm like, oh, really? They go, yeah, it was a good deal. I only paid $295 for it. It was $319 last month. I'm like, okay, how much is it worth? Huh? Yeah. Listen, I don't care what methodology you use. You can do what I do, which is, you know, enterprise value to revenue. Or, you know, if it's a profitable company, I'll look at price to earnings. I'll look at cash flow. I'll look at EV to EBITDA. Have a metric, figure out what it's worth. Like, so you know if you're underpaying or overpaying for it. You know, it's like none of these people would go out and buy a Honda Accord, you know, at the dealership without first looking at Kelly's Blue Book or Edmunds or, you know, to see what dealer invoice is and, you know, what dealer cost is. And then they're like, oh, okay, so, you know, dealer cost was $28,000. I'll offer him $28,500, you know, whatever. I mean, they have a, you know, they don't just go and say, oh, well, I don't know what that Honda's worth. But I mean, that's the same thing with a stock. I mean, look, these are all cliches and it's old advice, but, you know, you're buying a share of a business, right?
Right.
You know, maybe this person who just told me he bought Apple, you know, maybe he owns an advertising agency, right? Well, you know that business, right? You're not going to go and buy another advertising agency without figuring out what the billings are and how profitable it is and what the costs are and how long the contracts are. You got to look at a stock that way. You got to look at the business. You can't just say it's cheap because it was more expensive, you know, last month. I mean, you know, go back to the 2000 bubble and look at the garbage there that, you know, people bought all the way down. I mean, crap companies like CMGI. I mean, Tesla is going to be another one of those, by the way. And again, we're not going to spend a lot of time on it here, but you know, it's in a really bad industry, and you know, it's now, you know, $700 and something, $774. It got up to $960 at one point this month. I mean, it went crazy. I mean, you know, somebody saw Tesla at $960 and says, oh, now it's a bargain. It's only $774. I'm like, okay, let's go through the numbers. Huh? I don't know. You know. So you got to do that with any stock you buy. You have to figure out what it's fundamentally worth. So then you know you're getting a good price on it, not based on what it was last week.
Yeah, it goes back to that old saying, and I always forget who the quote is from, but the fool knows the price of everything and the value of nothing.
Essentially, right. Yeah. So yeah. Yeah. That's my best advice to anybody who wants to buy individual stocks is learn how to figure out what the company's worth. And look, we can all have different opinions on that. Some people put a higher value on growth. Other people put a higher value on the balance sheet, you know, and that's fine. I mean, that's what makes a market. But at least have some methodology so that you can figure out if you're overpaying or underpaying for the thing.
But in the process of doing that, people tend to forget, and I'm just talking about all the people that I interact with, just kind of the average Joe out there. They forget that you're buying profit, or at least future profit. You're buying cash flow at the end of the day, whether that's cash flow now or cash flow in the future. You're not buying something, just some random inanimate object that you think is going to go up in price just because there's going to be a greater fool out there, or because the Fed's going to print money. Now, again, if that's part of your portfolio that's exclusively for speculation, okay, I kind of get it. But even there, I think looking at something that's cheap and understanding that you're buying at least present cash flow or future cash flows at profit at some point in time.
Well, look, I mean, there's a lot of stuff which has tons of negative present. I mean, look at Netflix, right? Up there, you know, Uber. I mean, yeah, you know, Netflix $3 billion a year or whatever it is in negative free cash flow or more. And but yeah, I mean, these guys are coming up with models and justifying their purchase based on what they think this company will be generating in 10 years or whatever. Okay, fine. Listen, that's a methodology. You know, to me, that's betting too much on the come, you know. But, you know, that said, I'll never be a VC, right? Because I'm just not built that way. I'm just too skeptical. But there's nothing wrong with being an optimist. And, you know, look, eventually, unless it's a non-viable business, eventually the money printing will maintain the price of your company, unfortunately, but in some ways, but that's the way it is. I'm a realist about this stuff, you know?
When I first got, even before I was an entrepreneur, I retired in 2012, but before I got into that, I played blackjack a lot. It was so you kind of train your brain to look at things from a standpoint of probabilities. And the way I look at investment strategies is really, there's kind of a few components of it. Number one is your probability of, if you do this 10 times, how many of those 10 times will it go up in price? Okay, then you've got asymmetry. So if it does go up in price, is your upside 2 if you're gonna lose one bet, or is your upside 10? You know, what's your upside, what's your downside? And then third is volume. Because you can have a losing strategy, and if you only place that bet or investment or speculation 10 times, even though it maybe has a 40% chance of winning, you think it's got a 60% chance. There is maybe a 20 to 15% chance that out of those 10 bets, you actually come out ahead. But if you do that 100 times or 1,000 times, then you're guaranteed to lose. So I'll ask you this question. We can kind of go off on it. And it's the question that I always get when it's the answer that I always give when I get a question in the comments, like, George, well, yeah, but if you wouldn't have been invested in Tesla, as an example, you would have missed out on all of these gains from, you know, call it 300 to 900. And the way I always respond to that is, listen, let's say you're at the blackjack table and you're there with a buddy and you both have 19. Okay. He hits on the 19, you stay. He gets a 2 and gets blackjack. So you stay, and let's say the dealer gets 20 and you lose. So who made the right decision there?
Right.
And who made the wrong decision?
Right. You see,
most people would have a different answer for that. I would say that the guy who lost,
of course,
made the right decision, because over time they're going to win. When the guy who hit, I made the wrong decision, although he made money then, over the long term, he's going to go bust.
Listen, everybody who has their favorite, you know, nonsensical story stock, bubble stock, says, well, what about Amazon? Amazon was 1 in 10,000, man. Amazon is a freak and a fluke of nature. I mean, you know, and that's all Jeff Bezos, by the way. I mean, I was short Amazon for a little while, even before I worked on Wall Street in like 1999. I'm like, come on, this valuation is nuts. He was the one, and I was even short Amazon when I had the fund a few years ago from, you know, like I shorted it for a specific reason in the high 300s and covered in the low 400s very quickly. I thought AWS, you know, was slowing down, and it didn't. And sometime after that, I saw Bezos actually speak at a lunch, and they asked him, you know, why did you spend so long before you would break out AWS if it was doing so great? Because the average CEO would be saying, well, this is only 2% of our business, but it's growing at 180% a year, and he'd be pumping his stock. And Bezos didn't break it out until he had to, when I think it was more than 10% of revenue. And he said, this thing was doing so, making us so much money, I didn't want our competitors to know about it. And when I heard that, I'm like, this guy is good, as if it weren't already obvious, right? But Bezos is 1 in a million CEOs. Amazon is, you know, 1 in 10,000 or maybe 1 in 50,000 companies. And, you know, and just because you have your pet stock happens to be, you know, Tesla or CMGI back in, you know, 2000 or whatever. No, that's, you know, Amazon was a fluke. You know, not everything is Amazon. So that's exactly what you just said in terms of blackjack odds. And yeah, I mean, I did that too in high school. I was in high school when Atlantic City casinos first opened, and we used to go. You know, back then the book was Stanford Wong had written a book, and a guy named Lawrence Revere had written a book.
Yeah, I had Lawrence Revere's book.
And of course the original was
Ed Thorpe Beat the Dealer.
Thorpe Beat the Dealer, and you know, it was fun. But you know, when you're a kid in high school, I mean, to your point, you don't really have enough time or money to play 5,000 hands or whatever it is that you need, you know, 1,000 hands that you need to be sure you're going to win with your 1.5% edge or whatever it is. And after a while, it just gets very boring anyway. But at any rate, yeah, I mean, most things are not the next Amazon. In fact, nothing. You can safely bet that your company is not the next Amazon. Sorry about that, you know?
Yeah, but what the average investor, I think, needs to realize is, going back to that strategy, is that if they have a strategy that's only going to yield them a 50% probability of winning over the long term, then they have to have asymmetry in their upside and downside.
Exactly.
And yeah. So many people just look at an individual investment and say, oh, I've got a potential 5x return here.
Right.
Well, I'm going to go ahead and buy it. Well, no, wait a minute here. That it depends. You've got to look at your entire portfolio, because if you have that 5x potential with every single investment in your portfolio, but you only had, let's say, a 20% hit rate, then if you do that long enough, again, you're going to lose. You've got to have all of those dynamics and those metrics.
Well, right. So, that, you know, on a stock, part of that is coming back to, well, how much can I lose? And, you know, but if we're talking about venture capital, then sure, you can lose it all. But that's why I'd be a terrible VC, because I never think anything is going to work. I wouldn't have thought Amazon was going to work. I wouldn't have thought Facebook was going to work. Yeah, I wouldn't have thought, you know, Google was going to work. Yeah, I might have thought it would have worked and been like a nice little business, but I never would have paid probably what those guys were looking for then. I mean, I thought Google were idiots when they paid $1 billion for YouTube, right? And now we just saw the numbers and it's generating double digit billions every year in ad revenue. So that's just not my thing. I'm a pessimist. I'm not an optimist. That's what a value investor tends to be. But God bless guys who bet on Google, because I love it.
Yeah. You know? Yeah, but their strategy, they have to have a lot of asymmetry. Yes. Because yeah, they're going to have low volume and low probability.
Probably had 100 bets and all you needed was one Google out of 100 bets. But Google is one out of 1,000 too. There are, you know, Google's one out of 100,000, right? I mean, one out of 1,000,000, literally probably one out of, there are probably plenty of VCs who go bust because, you know, they lose 90 out of 100 bets and the other 10 don't do that well either, you know? So, yeah.
So I don't want to really get into the weeds on Tesla, because again, I know you do that so much and you're probably tired of talking about it. But what I'm fascinated by is the market dynamics between how it can just do this vertical hockey stick like Bitcoin did. There cannot be that many buyers. And it seems like, it could have been partly due to a short squeeze, but it doesn't seem like it would go up that much with a short squeeze. It's almost like someone just came in from outer space with $500 billion and bought the stock. Does that work from a market participant standpoint?
Yeah, so nobody really knows what happened there. Matt Levine, who writes a great column for Bloomberg, wrote a column about how nobody really knows. I think the FT guys at Alphabill wrote that column. You know, there were theories, various things. It probably wasn't that much of a short squeeze, because short interest had been about as low as it had been in probably a year. And, you know, at that point, like, you know, the convert hedge guys, you know, they'd be like actually shorting more at that point rather than getting squeezed, you know, to hedge their convert positions. So, I mean, the best guess that I have is there was a lot of, well, first of all, a bubble just happens, right? I mean, what happened with tulip bulbs? What happened with beyond me. It catches the fancy, in this case, of millions of retail investors, right? I mean, you know, I saw stories, guys on Twitter who said, you know, their kids' high school investing club, all they wanted to talk about was buying Tesla, right? I mean, this was the proverbial, you know, shoeshine boy who said, hey, I just bought Tesla, I can't lose. So it was a lot of that, but it couldn't be all that because, you know, here we had a $600, $700, $800, $900 stock, you know, trading 30, 40, 50 million shares a day. That's a lot of dollar volume, right? So I don't think that could be all retail, even on the margin. But for a while, Tesla had really fat option call premium. And I think a lot of pros, including me, an alleged pro, had sold way out of the money call options and collected that fat premium. And I rarely do it, but I, you know, I had shorted January 2021. So now there's, you know, call it a year left in this past January. You know, they were 690s. I shorted them in when the stock was in the low 300s. And I got like $17 for them, which for something that far out of the money, I mean, it was like unheard of, right? And I know a lot of really smart guys who are, I'm not typically an option guy. I know guys who are much more option oriented than I am and real math geniuses who did the same thing. They were just collecting that premium. Then with whatever kicked this off, and maybe it was all of a sudden, you know, retail investors going crazy, or, you know, maybe somebody pulled it off. Maybe some options maker said, hey, let's see if we can get something going here. Well, at that point, as the stock goes up, the guys who are short those calls, you know, wind up buying them in, which drives the stock up, you know, further. I mean, they're either buying the calls or they're hedging against their short call position. And it just becomes a big spiral going up, 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 yeah, until you have that blow off top where it hit 968. And then, you know, a day later, it was in the 700s or whatever. And by the way, you know, I'm not convinced it's certainly not recoupled with reality. So I'm not, you know, in terms of valuation, I'm not convinced, right? I'm not convinced that we won't have an echo bubble. I mean, I looked at some old charts. I looked at Bitcoin when it had its blow off top to 20,000. I went back to 2000 and looked at JDS Uniphase, JDSU, which had one of these, and Qualcomm, which had one of these. And they both had echo bubbles to varying degrees. And the echo bubble peak tends to be anywhere between, you know, call it 85% and maybe 95% of the previous high, which means I wouldn't be surprised if this thing bounced back to like the low 900s before it ultimately collapsed. And as I said, you know, tonight it's in like the high 700s. So, you know, there's just no explanation for these things. They happen, and there's probably multiple explanations.
One thing I wanted to talk about is the pension crisis that we have in the United States. And I know you're not only a bottoms up guy, but you really study the macro, which is, it's kind of rare where people have a really good understanding of both. But it's the perfect storm that I see is you've got these pensions that are dramatically underfunded. They're taking a tremendous amount of risk. And you have these baby boomers, a glut of population that has been starved of yield because of 0% interest rates for the last 12 years. So the their savings is extremely underfunded. The pension funds are underfunded. Not only that, they're going so far out the risk curve, and I'd want to add they're even levering up when they go out the risk curve just to try to get that 7%. So you know as well as I do that recessions are not a matter of if, but they're a matter of when. And so when we get that next recession, and by the way, we're so long in the tooth right now, I think we've gone to the longest expansion in U.S. history as of right now. But how does that dynamic work out with the pensions, the demographics, and everything so far? Everything's gotten so risky, and but yet volatility is at an all-time low. Go figure.
Well, this is something else that the Fed is aware of, and it's going to try to inflate away these obligations. You know, I mean, they come up with every different kind of story for, you know, why they're aiming for, you know, to create more inflation. But the real answer is the debt and the pension obligations. So, yeah, I mean, look, it's another reason. Look, if I had to have one asset for the next 50 years, yeah, probably be gold or maybe real estate. It would be some kind of hard asset. But I don't know the timing of this thing, and nobody does. And anybody who comes on your show or any other show, and this is not a dig of anybody in particular, with this Cassandra-like warning that, oh, you got to sell everything. We're going to have a crash next Tuesday. You got to buy gold. Well, you know, we should have a stock market correction for some reason. You know, the bigger the bubble gets, the thinner the walls are, and the easier it is to pop it. But I can guarantee you that when we get that, instead of printing $60 billion a month, the Fed will start printing $80 or $100 or $120 billion a month, you know? And the federal budget deficit, instead of being $1.2 trillion, will go up to $2 trillion or $3 trillion or whatever it is. And the ultimate end result of this will be the destruction of the U.S. dollar. But I don't know how long it's going to take. And, you know, you can go broke betting on that.
I watched an interview with Druckenmiller the other day. I believe it was on Bloomberg, where he said that throughout his career, he had never seen a bubble burst while the Fed was actually lowering interest rates. And he was talking about how he was actually net long. This was probably a couple months ago, but he was saying he was actually net long, and that was the reason why. And he said he was most likely going to stay net long until the Fed started to reverse course, and instead of going down to zero, started to go back up again. So do you have any thoughts on that?
Druckenmiller is as good as it gets. He totally understands this stuff. He totally gets it. I think I'll tell you the best macro call I ever heard in my life, because he was right for the right reasons, was in 2010 when David Tepper came on Squawk Box and he said, "I am balls to the wall long." And he literally said that. And I think then he corrected himself. And he said, "Here's why." And this was like when QE was just starting. He's like, you know, either the economy is going to boom and I'll make a ton of money on my stocks, or the Fed is going to print, and I'm paraphrasing him, so much damn money that they're going to drive up asset prices no matter what happens with the economy, and I'll still make a ton of money on my stocks. And the reason I have massive respect for that is he was right for the right reasons.
Right. You know,
that same era on CNBC, all these guys were coming on going, "Oh, the economy always bounces back great. You got to own stocks because the economy is going to boom." And as bad as it was in 08 and 09, early 09, we're going to get the mirror image of that now. Blah, blah, blah. No, we didn't get the mirror image. We had shitty GDP growth for the last 10 years, right? But Tepper was right for the right reasons. And now, of course, the entire market has adopted that attitude, which is the Fed has your back. They're going to print money and drive up stock prices. And I can't say that they're wrong, right? So, you know, we are way overdue for a real good correction, you know, and this coronavirus could drop stocks 20% tomorrow morning, right? Other than the halts or whatever we have. But, you know, in 3 weeks, it could drop. But I don't know how long stock prices will stay down, because the Fed has... And I despise this expression. The Fed has this tool in its toolbox. I mean, going back to what you said before, you know, you have a hammer, everything looks like a nail. As soon as Bernanke started talking about tools in the toolbox, I wanted to punch that guy in the face, because it's perfectly acceptable for them now in their mind to just print money for any reason whatsoever. They will print up asset prices again. And, you know, that's where I differ from, you know, many other bears who I think aren't getting that. You know, they don't understand that the Fed will do whatever it takes to print up nominal prices. And when you're short something, unless you somehow have some kind of crazy hedge, you're short that thing nominally.
Yeah. You could have been short the Venezuelan stock market.
And you'd be destroyed. I mean, if you came up with the right hedge, you know, if you were long the dollar against the Bolivar, whatever their currency is, yeah, maybe it would have worked. I never checked that out, that math. But it's the, again, going full circle back to the beginning of our discussion, you're playing poker against the guy with a chip making machine on his lap. And, you know, that guy is going to call everything you do. And you got to keep that in mind. So, you know, it's one thing if you want to short a biotech because you read the data and you're sure its phase 3 trial is going to fail. Okay, great. You know, or if you know a company is a fraud, you know, or whatever. But you know, I mean, I mean, come on, Netflix is back up. I happen to see it in the 370s. I haven't had a position there in a while. I mean, that's a cash burning company. Yeah, it's got some value, but come on, but this is just money printing, and people, everyone now thinks the Fed has their back. And I don't think they're wrong. Now, again, correction way overdue, 15%, 20%, 22%. Hell, we had it in, when was it, early 18? Was it, right? Something like that, right? Or December, was it December of 18?
December of 18.
And we'll get that again. But I don't think we're going to see 40% now that the Fed has this quote unquote tool in its toolbox, which is money printing, you know?
Yeah. You know, as a former real estate guy, I'd really like to get your opinion right now on real estate, not all real estate, but kind of a specific brand. The U.S. real estate market is in a bubble. The only thing that I can see that's cheap in the United States right now is cash flow on certain rental properties in these little linear markets like Kansas City or Little Rock, Arkansas. So you can get cash flow. If you can get a 1% RV ratio, if you can find something like that, that's cheap. And then if you can buy that cash flow with 30-year fixed rate debt, that or mortgage, that mortgage is also cheap. So the only things that I see right now that are denominated in US dollars outside of what you do at the value investing in these micro caps is just this type of real estate. And it's not that the real estate in and of itself is cheap. It just has the least amount of downside to buy that cash flow and get paid to short the dollar. What do you think about that?
I think it's theoretically great, but I think it's also a big pain in the ass to rent apartments and small houses to people, and you have to deal with all kinds of crap, and you know it's not always easy to find a good tenant, and whatever you earn is well deserved. But you know, assuming theoretically that you don't mind getting calls about the plumbing at 2 o'clock in the morning, or you know, going and knock on the door for your rent, and you know, the guy says, oh, I'm sorry, I'll have it next week. And, you know, meanwhile, this guy has like a drug problem and he'll never have it. And you're going to spend 3 months in court with him. I mean, that's all part of the deal. But, you know, other than that, sure, theoretically, it's great to borrow 30-year money in this market as cheap as it is. And you have a hard asset. And, you know, when eventually a dollar does get destroyed, that's your house. If you buy it cheaply enough to begin with, you know, I think you'll do great. Is this what you're doing? I mean, it's not easy, is it, dealing with residential tenants?
It's all about property management. So in 2012, when I retired, that's what I did, is I started investing in real estate, and I went in heavy in 2012. I luckily just almost at the very bottom, and I bought a lot of rental property there. I sold some of it off, but I still have a portfolio. And I don't live in the United States. I don't spend much time in the U.S.
Where do you live?
I spend most of my time in Colombia. I'm in Medellin right now as I speak to you.
Oh, but what a great series on Netflix, the Narcos series. It was the best.
Yeah, it's actually boosted tourism quite a bit. But it's all about property management. If you got a great property manager and you got to kiss a lot of frogs for that, then it's realistic. If you don't have good property management, and if you don't have good people management skills and problem solving skills, then it's going to be tough. It's going to be difficult, especially trying to self-manage. So if you got a good property management company, like I might spend 2 hours a month actually, you know, calling.
You're exactly right. You've got a good management company, and then it's his headache and not your headache. As long as you buy these properties cheaply enough to allow for the legal fees and the guy is not paying the rent and the pipe that bursts in the middle. Yeah, absolutely. Sure. Yeah. No, it's great. I think that's a great hedge against the inflation that we all know is coming, but we just don't know when it's coming. Sure.
A lot of these financial advisors, a lot of people that you see online, a lot of these, you know, quote unquote financial gurus, they sit there and say, well, yeah, but if you look at the market over time, it always goes up. So even if it goes down in a dip, you just buy. And sooner or later, if you're a buy and hold, if you're a smart investor and you're just buying an index fund, you know, you're just buying something like that, that is a broad S&P, then you hold on to it for 20 years, you're always going to make money. And then look at all these stats going back to 1923. They never seem to look at markets, or they never seem to look at markets like Japan, where just because it's a stock market that's gone up for the last 50 or 60 years, it doesn't mean that it's going to go up forever. I mean, Japan, they were at, 50% of where they were in 1990. So, and just think about if you were in Japan, if you're a financial advisor in 88, or if you're Dave Ramsey or Susie Orman, I guarantee you that you would have been telling, or you would have heard that exact same thing on the radio. Well, if the market goes down in 1990, you always buy and it'll always come back. And why is that a fallacy? Why is that incorrect?
Well, so if you bought at the peak in 1929, right, I think it took till sometime in the mid to late 50s before it came back. If you bought at the peak of NASDAQ in 2000, when did NASDAQ get back there? I don't know, I have to pull up a chart, 15 years later, something like that. So, in their defense, even though this is not the reason they're giving you, we now have this money printing Fed, which we didn't have in the past, right? And this is the tool in their toolbox, and they're going to print money and drive up asset prices. And it's probably true that, over 20 years, you probably will come out ahead, in the S&P 500, versus many other things you can do because of the money printing. Otherwise, it would be a different deal. So,
but it could be just in nominal terms.
Oh, and correct. In nominal terms. That's correct.
Because so you could lose purchasing power. I mean, you could have your stock portfolio double and actually lose purchasing power.
Yeah, absolutely. Especially if you buy like right now at PEs of 26. And then if we get, this inflation or a stagflationary environment and multiples come down to 14 or 13 or 12 to account for higher interest rates. Yeah, that's correct. Yeah. I mean, it's very hard to call the top in a bubble, right? So I mean, look, I would say, and again, people have different tolerances for drawdowns and the size of their account and everything. But if you're young and we got a 20% correction over the coronavirus in the next couple of months, I'd say, yeah, what the hell? I'd throw it into the S&P if you've got a 30-year time frame. You'll probably come out ahead, and there probably aren't a lot of better things you can do with it, other than certain specialty things like, you are with your single family houses in the Midwest, which aren't bubble markets, if you can, but that's a whole different ball game.
All right, my last question for you, and I've always wanted to ask an experienced professional this. What do you think of the CAPE ratio?
Well, I mean, right now the CAPE ratio is, I think only the third time in history, if I'm right about that, that it's over 30, right? It was,
yeah.
It was 1929, it was, I think 2000 and now, if I'm not mistaken. Look, everyone will tell you it's not a good short-term timing tool because it could stay elevated like that for a long time. But it clearly means that stocks are very, very expensive now. And look, the whole fallacy, the whole reason this market is priced the way it is really is people have seen very low interest rates for a very long time, and they're just projecting into eternity that, the 10-year U.S. 10-year bond will yield, 1.5 to 2% or whatever, or maybe even 3%, right? And the 30-year will yield, right now it's probably around 2%, but maybe they're saying, well, it'll never get over 3.5 or 4%. So they're saying, well, 10-year Treasury, 2% yield forever. Well, I could pay 50 times earnings for a stock. They're using that basically. And if that were the case, that the 10-year Treasury would always yield 2%. Yeah, you could pay a big multiple for stocks. The problem, of course, is we're running $1 trillion plus deficits. The deficits are only going to get worse. The Fed is going to keep printing money. And eventually, the dollar will collapse. Interest rates will soar. And you can throw that spreadsheet out the window. I just don't know the timing. And nobody does. And anybody who tells you they do, is just selling something that isn't there,
Yeah.
Just be careful. You realize it's a bubble and be really careful. And other than that, it's hard. That's why I'm happy I have my little niche, even though I can't find enough of these little companies. Anytime I stray from that niche in this crazy market, it's, shorting big cap bubbles, I've gotten burned. I made some money on some of them, but part of it, I was just lucky that I covered them when the Fed started printing again, because most of them are up now too, Find an inefficient market. For me, it's nano cap value. For you, it's, real estate. Houses in the Midwest, real estate in the Midwest. That's
Yeah, now I do a lot of real estate in Colombia as well. And if you want to talk about an inefficient market where only 3% of the population has a mortgage, I mean, wow, there is some mega inefficiencies here. But yeah, that's a great point for the average person out there, is just try to, you know, have a specialty, have a niche, and look for inefficient markets.
Yeah, I mean, look, the issue, look, I know nothing about Colombia other than what I've seen in movies. I would, my fear there would be political risk, you know, where everything is fine now and they respect your property rights. But, you know, what happens if it swings the other way and a socialist comes in and destroys your property? I'm not saying that would happen, by the way, but but political stability is really, really important wherever you invest, unless you're really, really well paid for that risk. You know, I mean, if you can buy a house in some politically unstable place, but get all your money out of it in 3 years and everything after that is gravy, okay, you take that risk. But people need to think about that also.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, Mark. Well, I really appreciate your time. It was just really a special treat for me, and really an honor to be able to ask someone.
Don't be honored, but it was fun for me. I really enjoyed it. It was a lot of fun. Anytime you want to do it. Thank you very much for the chance to come on here and pontificate for an hour.
Well, it was really great. So if people want to find out more about Stanfill Capital or what you do, do you have a website, or should they just follow you on Twitter?
I have a very basic bare bones website. It's stanphylcap, Stanfill, stanphylcap.com. But on there is really my contact info, my email. You can follow me on Twitter. You know, it's some finance, some, you know, politically incorrect jokes and all kinds of other stuff. And my Twitter handle is at Mark B as in boy Spiegel, S-P-I-E-G-E-L. And yeah, I mean, you know, again, thank you for this opportunity. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, for sure. Let's do it again soon.
Okay, take care.